Everyone knows they need a liveness probe and readiness probe configured in their Kubernetes manifests. But what many people don't know is that there are 5 attributes that can actually bite you in the ass. And this happens because when you configure the liveness and readiness probes, we usually give it only the mandatory configuration fields. But we have 5 other fields that are the period of seconds that our application is going to be probed, the timeout seconds, the success threshold, the failure threshold, and all of those configurations that come with default attributes can really hurt us. And there are many stories in the internet, including Datadog's, that they actually had an outage because their timeout period for a probe check was just 1 second, and it was just wasn't enough. So let's go over the liveness probe and readiness probe configuration and the default attributes that you want to set according to your application's configuration. So let's talk about a liveness probe and readiness probe. So why do we need them? So we have a readiness probe that actually acts as the initial check to make sure that our process is ready to receive traffic. So maybe we need to go and pull data from a database in order to cache it and then serve the traffic and so on and so on. So we can use a readiness probe to know and notify Kubernetes when it is safe to start sending traffic. The second one is a liveness probe, which actually helps Kubernetes check whether our application is still working correctly. Now, it is very important to not lie to yourself and configure a liveness probe that does not really check the entirety of your application. And I'll give you an example. Things that people do is they go and just return a response 200 for a health check, while their application actually goes and talks to a database and a queue and a cache, and they don't test all of those connections. And at the end of the day, it's just lying to yourself. It's just setting up a liveness probe that does not really represent your application. So how do we actually do this? We have 3 options. Number one is we can set an HTTP check. Obviously, this is for your web apps and for you to go and check your web application using the HTTP method. The second one is a TCP named port. Let's say you have an application that just, maybe it's a DNS server, maybe it's an app that just simply works with raw TCP ports, then this check is for you. And the third one is an exec command, and this is what happened to Datadog because they wanted to check a Redis cluster, so they used a Redis ping, so they just executed the command and they read the exit command in order to see whether it is alive or not. So now that we know what are the checks that we're going to talk about, there's one check that we're not going to talk about, which is the startup check. Startup probe, it is more intended for legacy workloads and workloads that take a lot of time to spin up. And if this is something that is relevant to you, you can read more about it. So let's dive deeper into the defaults that we have for all of those configurations and what should we avoid when we do that. Okay, so let's talk about the default parameters and the settings that they provide with themselves. So let's start with the first one, which is initial delay in seconds. The default is set to 0. So this parameter defines how long should Kubernetes wait before it starts to probe our workload. Now, this can be problematic in a case where you start up your application and it has some sort of a startup sequence. Maybe it pulls data from a database and caches it. Maybe it waits for other resources to become available. And if we do not set the initial delay seconds that is enough for application to start, we can actually encounter problems later on with other parameters that we're going to talk about, like the failure threshold and success threshold, where Kubernetes will deem our application inoperable, even though it might be totally okay, it just did not have enough time to initially start itself. The second configuration that we're going to talk about is the period seconds. This configuration determines how long should Kubernetes wait in between checks to see whether our application is alive. The default settings is 10 seconds. And we should ask ourselves, what type of application are we running? And is 10 seconds enough? Is it too much or too low? I'll give you an example. If I have a payment application and it is very, very important for me to make sure that it is up and running, and if my health check does not take a lot of resources, maybe I want to even initiate a period seconds that is lower than 10. On the other hand, maybe we have an application that is very heavy lifting. It does a lot of operations. And number one, the health check itself is costly. And number two, maybe it's some batch processing or something that is, I don't know, log collecting and that is not so important. Maybe we want to put it into 1 minute, 2 minutes, up to you. Next, we have the timeout seconds. And as you remember in the Datadog story, this is actually the one that bites them in the ass. And the problem here is that it is default to 1 second. And maybe your application, 1 second is simply not enough. And you need to give it 3, 5, 10 seconds to respond. And this is up to you for configuration. And the final two parameters that I want to talk about is the failure threshold and the success threshold. So this is the amount of times that Kubernetes will actually try to see and try again and again if our workload is working correctly. So the default for the failure threshold is 3 times. So it can fail 3 times until Kubernetes will deem it unworthy for continuing to serve traffic and try to restart it. On the other hand, the success threshold default is one time. And now let's take 2 use cases. On the first use case, let's use the payment one. So maybe I have a payment settings and a user comes to pay and he puts in his credit card and he clicks on pay and he gets an error. This is a catastrophical error for us because it really costs us money, and maybe at this point our customer might leave us and never perform the purchase again. So maybe I want to have a failure threshold of 1 and a success threshold of 5 to really make sure that my service works correctly. And maybe the period in seconds that I want to check is 5 seconds, because this is really a crucial service for me. On the other hand, we might have the opposite of that. Maybe we have some service that collects general telemetry and we have a client that we control and the client has retries, and we have many of those different services and we don't really want to waste a lot of resources on that. So maybe the failure threshold might be even 5, and maybe the success threshold might be 1, and the period seconds that we want to examine it might be 1 minute, 2 minute, 3 minute, because it is really graceful for us and nothing really happens if it does not respond immediately. Another one thing to note is that if our application is a bit flaky, you know, sometimes there are timeouts, maybe it's error prone in terms of networking and so on, then again, we maybe want to give it more wiggle room and increase the failure threshold, increase the period seconds, and give it some time to actually respond before we decide to kill it. So I hope that I've convinced you to customly define your probes fields and to make sure that you always have your custom configuration that fits your application, and to never ever rely on the default Kubernetes configuration. And in order to do so, you can use our own Datree open source solution that scans every Kubernetes manifest file and your cluster and identifies in which liveness and readiness probes are you not defining the custom fields. And this way you can make sure that you actually configured it correctly. So check it out at datree.io.